Good evening, everyone. My name is Terry Sullivan, and this, once again tonight, is the Inside Corner. The topic this evening is one about the therapeutic benefits of sports massage. I know many of you are massage clients. For instance, Massage Envy Spa here in LaGrange does a viable business, and it's only one of several massage therapy choices in the LaGrange area. It happens to be the largest in the LaGrange, Western Springs, Brookfield area. But all of these places are doing, you know, viable business. They're coming along, they're growing, and so there must be many clients out there who believe in the therapeutic benefits of massage. Well, since our show does everything it possibly can to orient viewers, particularly athletes and families of athletes, about the various aspects of athletic involvement, it dawned on me that the popularity of massage therapy and its connection to athletics might be something you're interested in, particularly the sports therapy massage for the athlete who's bruised up after a hard football game on a Saturday, or the distance runner, the mom or dad trying their chances in the Chicago Marathon, and what sports therapy that massage has to offer in regard to the conditioning of the athlete and the prevention of injuries. So I have asked an expert in various categories of massage, but particularly in sports massage therapy, if he would not join us tonight. He is one Andy Lukasiewicz. I got it. Andy Lukasiewicz, who happens to be a massage therapist employee at Massage Envy Spa here in LaGrange. It's on the northeast corner of Hillgrove Avenue and LaGrange Road, upstairs above the AT&T store. And he's here to tell us, theoretically and in reality, what the benefits of massage might be for you, student athlete, and moms and dads who have sports involvements of their own, including things mildly involving, like golf, for instance. Is there an applicable massage for golf? We'll find out. So, Andy,
yes.
you're a graduate of the Redfern Training Systems?
Correct.
And you've been a massage therapist for 12 years, 5 years at your present place of employment at Massage Envy Spa in LaGrange. And you are a certified, licensed massage therapist in not only sports massage, but deep tissue massage, Swedish massage, myofascial massage, trigger point, and believe it or not, even prenatal.
That is correct.
Therapeutic massage. All right, I got that straight. Good. So, you know, I receive massage.
Yes.
I never thought I'd be a candidate for it. I had a phobia about anyone touching me, probably because I'm insecure and I'm not satisfied with my appearance. But nonetheless, I was phobic about massage. I'd never do that. My wife was doing it, but I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to go over there and get undressed and have someone touch me. No, it's not for me. And then I had some real needs. I had some back issues, and I said, I'll try anything at this point in time, and oh my God. That was probably 8 years ago. And I receive massage now twice a month, and I am a fan and addicted nonetheless. The only massage I've had is deep tissue massage.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't know much of anything about the others, but I've been taught through reading and interaction with massage therapists that there are a whole list of benefits, general benefits. The one that befuddles me the most is the use of water after a massage, and this supposedly is flushing toxins from my body. Okay, now you need to convince me about that, because I'm not buying into it a whole lot.
So the biggest thing, the two biggest benefits for massage is increased blood flow and increased lymphatic flow. So your blood has its own natural pump, the heart, so that will automatically kind of help filter your system with the toxins that happen in the blood. The lymphatic system doesn't have its own pump. And that's where massage is so crucial mm-hmm. to help remove those toxins mm-hmm. from the lymphatic mm-hmm. system. We help facilitate the flow towards the heart so it can get filtered naturally, and hydrating will help flush those toxins
out. Is this because you're making direct contact with lymphatic areas?
Yes, correct.
And you can feel that lymph system? I mean, it has nodes, but I don't think they're palpable.
They
are palpable on the surface?
Well, not necessarily on the surface, but they're in there, and you can
somewhere.
Feel them.
Yeah. We all know we have lymph underneath our arms, probably in this area.
All over the body.
All over the place and below the waist.
Correct.
Okay. And so you're telling me that your therapy, your manipulation of those areas, mm-hmm. the application of your science to those areas helps lymphatic system efficiency.
Yes.
It's going to flush the system.
Yes. In fact, there is a specific massage called lymphatic drainage that works specifically with just the lymph system to help facilitate that flow.
How does the client realize that, though?
Well, that really relies on the therapist to help educate the client on what their needs are.
What if I were a, I shouldn't say, I'm not going to pose an example with a client with a specific ailment or need. I would just, a guy comes in because he's tense.
Okay.
All right. And he needs to relax, and you can sense that right away when you touch them, right? The tension is...
Absolutely.
Yeah.
You know,
there's
tension from shortened muscles and tension from lengthened muscles. That's like the two biggest things that are important that what we deal with as massage therapists. So when a muscle's tight and it's lengthened, it's because it's stretched between an origin and an insertion point.
Right.
And, excuse me, if it's tight because it's shortened, it's usually shortened between the two points, and it's from overuse.
You
a lot
can feel
of times,
that constriction.
Absolutely.
All right. So this ordinary citizen comes in. He doesn't have any special intention. He doesn't say his neck hurts or his back hurts. He just wants a relaxation massage. And you dig in on this guy. I want to know, how does that regular Joe off the street, how do you prove to him that you've improved the lymphatic efficiency, the efficiency of his lymphatic system?
I think that's an excellent question.
Yeah. I'm going to be perfectly blunt with you.
Yeah.
Is he going to notice a difference in coloration in his urine?
That happens sometimes.
Is he going to urinate more? Is that why we're getting the water after the massage?
I mean, more frequency of urination is something
you've
that
given
happens.
Him water after the massage. Right?
Correct.
At Massage Envy, there's this wonderful practice of the therapist handing the client water on the way out.
And also it's to help promote just general hydration. Hydration is good for the body. It's good for the body at a cellular level, which in some cases, you get the benefits of massages on that cellular level.
Okay.
So if we can help rehydrate all the tissues in the body, you're gonna be at more optimal performance.
All right, if I had a real tight constriction, maybe even you could feel the lump in the muscle,
mm-hmm.
and you straighten that lump out, you dispersed it, so to speak. Does that lump contain some toxic material?
So for many years, there has been this promotion of lactic acid, which when your body goes into anaerobic respiration, you produce lactic acid. It's when you work out, when you feel that burn.
Right.
So for many years, we have been told that lactic acid sits in your muscle tissue, and water and massage can help facilitate removal of that lactic acid. Now, I'm skeptical in some ways that there is this new thought that the body actually naturally disperses the lactic acid within 20 minutes of physical activity.
Of the activity?
Yeah. So what we've been taught for years is actually false. So I'm skeptical. I haven't done enough reading on it yet, but there's those two thought processes in there. One is that the lactic acid does stay in the muscle tissue, and that even myself is something that I was taught when I went to school. Mm-hmm. And there's this new theory that it's the complete opposite, that the body naturally heals itself and removes those toxins.
But the massage is not an expediter of that? It doesn't
eat? Not that toxin specific, but there's multiple toxins that in the body that can store up in the muscle tissue.
And so your manipulation of the lymphatic systems, wherever they are, aids the flushing. Your training is that it will aid the flushing of the lymphatic system.
Correct.
With no tangible evidence of that to the client, other than the gallon of water you give him going out the door, which will make him pee more.
Yeah.
Huh? See what I mean? I'm just trying to get, before we get to these specific massages,
right.
I'm trying to demonstrate to the viewers,
for sure,
that for their student athletes at home, for the mom and dad themselves, that there's a general benefit. They don't have to be a weekend warrior,
right,
or someone with an injury. They can go for a massage and receive benefit, but the body chemistry benefits may be invisible to them.
In some cases you're not going to experience anything. You know, there's a lot of times though that because of the flushing of toxins that some people will feel lightheaded, mm-hmm, or dizzy, mm-hmm, or even kind of sick to their stomach.
Mm-hmm.
It really affects people differently. So there's really no one telltale sign of what's happened from the benefits of massage.
Okay. So client A comes in, he has no particular ailment or any particular intention for his massage. He just wants a general relaxing massage.
Mm-hmm.
You put your hands on this person and you know that he may have a problem that he doesn't realize.
Okay.
He may have extremely tight muscle structure that could cause an injury. Are you that good at it? You've developed an intuitive feel with your hands.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. I wouldn't say right away that you can necessarily feel that. Part of that is keeping in communication with the client. And I always tell my clients that what you feel is different than what I feel. So that being said, is that your experience and ailment and where you feel discomfort or pain or tightness might not correlate to exactly what I'm feeling. And
mm-hmm,
that's just because your nerves are interpreting what your nerves
right
are interpreting.
Right.
And I am physically feeling what I am interpreting through my hands from client A's body.
Yeah. Let me ask you this. The majority of your clients, do they come with a specific mission in mind for you? Do they an objective for you? They'll say, my neck is killing me, or my hips are killing me. Is that what you get, or?
I typically see a lot of people with very specific ailments.
Yeah.
So, you know, I have an issue with my shoulder, and I'd like that addressed. I have an issue with my legs, and I'd like that addressed.
All right. Let's dig into these categories.
You got it.
The one I'm most unfamiliar with is the myofascial.
So myofascial technique, how I kind of explain what fascial tissue is.
I said facial. I meant fascial.
That's okay. Facial and fascial are kind of interchangeable.
Whenever I say facial, I mean fascial.
So what it is I would kind of describe fascial tissue is, imagine going to the grocery store and buying steaks. So you have the styrofoam on the bottom,
mm-hmm,
you have two steaks, and then you have your cellophane. Okay, so the styrofoam is kind of like your bone, and the two steaks are kind of like your muscle tissue. And then the cellophane is kind of like this fascial tissue that sits on top of these muscles.
Yes.
Now if you can imagine those two steaks individually wrapped in cellophane,
yes,
and then wrapped again in cellophane.
Yes.
So when it's wrapped real tight in that top layer, everything, instead of moving as an individual steak,
yes,
two individuals, it kind of moves as one package. So what myofascial does is it helps relieve the adhesions on that fascial
adhesions
layer. Right. Yeah, that fascial layer.
So the adhesions are unduly connecting the fascial material to the muscle.
Correct.
There's an adhesion.
Correct.
Many people who have had surgery are going to have these adhesions.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, yeah.
Absolutely. Scar tissue happens. naturally in a lot of ways, but it also happens surgically in a lot of ways too. And we can help break up those adhesions. There unfortunately are some times where the adhesions can be too far to do great benefit. It's more of a time management.
Yes. Are they going to recur? Are they going to recur the adhesion?
They can. So
can you feel them with your hands?
Yes.
It's remarkable. I believe that because I just happen to believe generally in a lot of intuitive abilities.
Mm-hmm.
And I believe you can feel that. I don't know. It takes probably a lot of experience and someone at the beginning pointing it out to you.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
And some of it is just really like quieting down and listening to what your body is telling you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, which we're in a society that's so fast paced and so interested in overstimulation that we don't really take the time to quiet down and just really pay attention to what our body's telling us.
So what percentage of your massages are myofascial?
So I try to incorporate all tools
I thought you were going to say that. Almost everyone is, there's some myofascial.
There's some.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Yeah. There'd have to be.
Yeah, you try and use everything that you have in your tool bag as a therapist to do what's best for your client.
Mm-hmm.
So, and that's kind of, you know, and we could lead that into talking about sports massage if you'd like.
Okay, we'll do that. But hold on, Andy. Yeah. Hold that thought, as they say, because we have to treat our clients here and our viewers to a very, very brief public service announcement. We're going to be gone about, no, maybe it's a minute and a half, but we're right here at LTTV on your Comcast cable network and the package you purchased at exorbitant prices. Nonetheless, we'll be waiting for you right here. This is the Inside Corner. My name is Terry Sullivan. The topic is therapeutic massage with Andy Lukasiewicz from Massage Envy Spa in LaGrange. We'll be right back. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right here waiting for you. Thanks, everyone, for coming back. This is LTTV. My name is Terry Sullivan. The name of the program is The Insight Corner. The topic this evening is massage therapy, particularly sports massage therapy. And if you stick around, the next segment, we are going to demonstrate a sports massage. And hopefully I will be the model for that, and I'll get free massage. You know, that's one of the perks of this glamorous industry. Nonetheless, I'm here with an expert on the topic. He is an employee, a massage therapist at Massage Envy Spa in LaGrange. They happen to be right above the new AT&T store at the corner of Hillgrove and LaGrange Road. They're upstairs. It is the largest massage enterprise in the LaGrange, Western Springs, Brookfield, Hinsdale area, for that matter. He is 12 years a massage therapist, 5 years with Massage Envy Spa. His name is Andy Lukasiewicz, and a very informative fellow. And we have discussed the general benefits of massage, generally speaking, which includes the very particular benefit to the lymphatic system. But now I want to delve into some of these specific massage therapies. We talked about the myofascial. Okay, you are certified and licensed to do sports massage, deep tissue, Swedish, myofascial, trigger point, and prenatal.
Correct.
Yes. The prenatal massage.
Yes.
This is for pregnant ladies.
Absolutely.
Right? And can they receive massage right up through the full gestation?
Absolutely. Up until like going into labor, actually.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you have a high percentage of clients?
I have a smaller percentage of clients. Yeah. Typically, the clients that I see for prenatal are people who have seen, women who have seen me before, mm-hmm. and end up getting pregnant,
yes.
and wish to continue their treatments with me.
Yes. There has to be a whole lot of limiting guideline to the treatment of a lady who's pregnant, right?
Not as much as you would think. There are some limitations. It's more of just a different protocol. Obviously, a pregnant woman cannot really lay face down.
Yes.
Especially later in their pregnancy,
right.
when their belly is big.
Yeah, I have the same problem.
Right. So we adapt it and we do what's called a side lying position.
Side.
Yeah, so, and we can still do a lot of techniques in the side lying position. Some are actually even more beneficial for anybody.
Let me ask you: do they have to have a doctor's permission slip to do that?
Not a doctor's permission. They need to basically sign off an additional waiver saying that their doctors have approved them and that they're not at what's considered a high risk pregnancy.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay. Deep tissue.
Yep.
I know Swedish massage is not deep tissue.
Correct.
But I thought every other massage would be deep tissue.
That's not necessarily true. Actually, lymphatic drainage, it's not something that I've really been trained in, but lymphatic drainage is a much gentler approach, and it's still incredibly beneficial. It's really great for people who have arthritis,
mm-hmm.
Among other things. But no, not every other form of therapy is considered a deep tissue.
Deep tissue, what does it amount to? Just more pressure and deeper through the fascia, into the muscle, down to the bone?
No.
No.
So the big difference between Swedish and deep tissue is a therapist can perform a deep pressure Swedish massage. A deep tissue massage is actually going deeper, penetrating the multi-layers of muscle,
yes.
and getting specific muscle bands or muscle groups. That are in the deeper layers of muscle. So it's not something that you should go in like gangbusters and get in right away.
It's going to be a little painful, perhaps.
It can be.
Yeah.
You have to warm up the muscle. It's a slower technique getting in there. You can't. Swedish, you're really just more or less working superficial layers of the muscle tissue. Everything that sits on top. Now in the back, there's up to 6 layers of muscle tissue, if more.
Wow.
Yeah. And you know, I say if more because not everybody is built the same. Everybody has a different structure to their body. So sometimes through no fault of their own or things that have happened over the years, sometimes muscle groups can shift in an unnatural way
mm-hmm.
where they lie over different layers of the mm-hmm. muscle.
Okay. So the deep tissue massage is it very similar to the sports massage?
There are aspects of deep tissue that are sports.
Yes.
Sports massage is not. So the difference between like Swedish and deep tissue and myofascial and lymphatic and prenatal, what I've talked to, those are techniques. I personally feel that sports massage is more of an approach towards the body. It's not necessarily a technique because we use many different techniques in sports massage mm-hmm. to increase the blood flow,
yes.
increase the lymphatic flow, and increase the range of motion with a specific area designated per that particular sport that person participates in.
Okay, if I come in to see you, and by the way, I'm betting that lower back pain is the most common reason people are coming for massage.
I would say back pain in general, not necessarily low back. It's kind of,
okay,
I would say
pain.
It's 50-50
right.
low back, so upper back.
I come in either with back pain.
Yeah.
You are going to suggest, in my, this is my guess, deep tissue.
I'm going to suggest.
What?
What are you looking to achieve?
Oh, okay, yeah.
What is your goal with the
yeah.
massage? Are you just looking to relax? Are
okay,
you
I'm going to say my goal is no more pain.
Yeah.
And relaxation of that area.
Okay, so yeah, I would recommend for you deep tissue. But what we can do with that is, you know, we can mix the techniques together. Like I mentioned earlier,
yeah.
a therapist should use all the techniques in their tool bag. So it's not just one thing for the whole body or the specific area. But with sports, we typically focus on an area specific for that particular sport.
Okay, then what in the heck is trigger point?
So trigger point is a therapy that is a sustained pressure in the muscle tissue on a specific trigger point. Now, trigger points develop just from general tension and tightness.
Okay, so a trigger point is not necessarily on top of a nerve.
No.
It's
It's although the nerves are throughout the whole body. So
right. So a trigger, you determine what the trigger points are through instruction from your client. This is where it hurts me?
They would say this is where it hurts. There is a specific kind of guideline where trigger points typically lie.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's kind of a subjective thing just because everybody's body is so different.
Yeah. So when you dig in on that trigger point,
mm-hmm.
does the client feel pain?
They feel it. Yeah. It is not necessarily the most comfortable thing in the world.
Yeah, I thought so, yeah.
But usually, the good thing is that the nerves that are designated to feel that pain response typically do fatigue. And as they fatigue, the pain seems to lessen and lessen.
Yes.
And also, the muscle will typically elongate, and it'll open that and allow for blood to really flush into that area.
There are people who just want to be touched ever so lightly.
Yep.
Correct? They just want almost like a Reiki massage. I mean, a Reiki massage, as I understand, is just it's a mystical, magical thing.
Reiki is energy.
Energy manipulation,
work.
Yes. Yeah. It's another topic altogether.
There you go.
But there are those who describe their massages to me like they were Reiki massages with hands not touching the body. And then there are those who really want the therapist to dig in there and really hurt me because it hurts so good.
Right.
Yeah. What's the majority on that?
So it just really depends on how each therapist really defines what they do within the realms of massage. I kind of consider myself sports, deep tissue, kind of rehabilitative.
Yes.
In what
That's
I
why
do.
You're here. Yeah.
But a lot of people really focus on the Swedish, and there are lots of people who really enjoy that and love that. And there are therapists who really focus on that who are incredible at it.
Yes. Talking about your relationships with clients, the magic of touch, of human touch on the body, I'm calling it the magic, it undoubtedly has benefit. The comforting, secure feeling of someone artfully massaging your body and manipulating your body can, as I've been told, and I think I have felt it myself, release emotion,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yes.
Okay. Now we're getting into a real can of worms, because I'm thinking that you are not only a massage therapist, but you may very well be a counselor therapist, because people might just open up to the massage therapist due to the warm, secure, comfortable feeling they have with you, correct? Particularly the one who's a regular client.
Absolutely.
Are you fielding questions that you think is for another realm?
Fielding, yes.
Yeah.
Answering, responding, that's not necessarily my forte.
Right,
so
yeah.
I do my best to divert or just listen,
which is just listen, what
any human can do.
Yeah, this is the same effect that the hairdressers and doctors and other medical personnel, they confess to, I wind up being a psychologist. Yeah, and so you do experience that and artfully deflect those,
yes.
All right, well, it's time now to delve into this main topic, which is sports massage and how it might be applicable and germane to your student athlete at home and to you yourself and your sports activities. Okay, the sports massage, popular, isn't it?
And you know, we have especially here, you know, I feel that the surrounding communities are really focused on health and well-being.
Right.
So we do see a lot of weekend warriors and people who are dedicated to keeping their body in shape.
Lots of runners.
I would say that's probably the majority of the athletes that we see.
Yeah, they're runners, and they've do they come to you in preparation for an event or repair and rehabilitation afterwards? Which
so both, sports massage is. That's a great segue into me responding this way.
Yeah.
Sports massage has four aspects to it. So there's the pre-event, the post-event, restorative, and rehabilitative. So pre is usually 15 to 45 minutes before an event. So if we're talking about somebody that's running a marathon, so it would be 15 minutes to 45 minutes before the race. And it's something to really quickly induce the blood flow and really invigorate the area of the body that's being used, so mostly the legs. Post, it's more to help calm down the muscle and reduce inflammation, kind of help facilitate everything towards the heart to help filter. Restorative is there to, throughout working out and building up to a race or an event of any kind, and that's to help somebody who can push harder with their training and reduce the chances of injury. And then rehabilitative is kind of the opposite of that. It's when somebody suffers an injury, how do we change the massage to get them back on track to where they need to be?
Now, let me ask you a question. This comes to mind. Do you think running is injurious?
I'm sorry, can you repeat that?
Is running, long distance running, as a massage therapist, do you feel it's injurious to the body? Is it damaging the body?
For some people, yes. Yeah. You know, it really depends on, so something that I'm not necessarily trained in is evaluating somebody's gait.
Yeah.
So a lot of times it could be something that we could refer out to a movement therapist.
Right.
And they can help get somebody's body back on track.
Yeah.
And then after that, we get that body.
Yeah, that must be the person who's coming in. You do your four approaches.
Mm-hmm.
And they keep coming back with the same problem. So it must be a mechanical problem.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, and that's the definition of insanity, as we know.
Right.
It's doing
right.
the same thing over and over again, expecting a different
result. And not getting
exactly.
Good. Yeah. Okay. Well, you're gonna demonstrate some of the sports massage
not
approach,
a problem.
Right?
Sounds great.
Wow. And I'm gonna be the recipient. Yes. I hope you're understanding that there are multiple benefits to massage therapy, and as Andy has explained. And when you come back in a brief amount of time, Andy has brought his portable table, and I'm going to act as the client, and he's going to narrate for you exactly what he's doing as he administers a very brief and condensed sports massage to my horrible, dilapidated body. My name is Terry Sullivan. This is the Insight Corner. You're watching LTTV. We're not going to be gone long. Don't miss this. Come back. We'll be right here waiting for you, okay? Thanks for coming back, everyone. We've had change of scenery, huh? Change of wardrobe. My name is Terry Sullivan. This is the Insight Corner. The topic this evening has been, for the last half hour, it has been sports massage therapy and the benefits of, the therapeutic benefits of massage. We have with us a relative expert, Andy Lukasiewicz from Massage Envy Spa in LaGrange, and we have discussed all of the peculiarities, all of the specifics of massage therapy. And now, lo and behold, Andy is going to demonstrate some of the sports massage approach and technique. And perhaps we can all learn from that. And I get to have a free massage. Now, that's not a bad deal, is it? Okay. So, with no further ado, Andy, are you going to help narrate this for me?
Absolutely. Right, so I'm going to have you lie face down.
All right. Thank you. Oh, boy, sleeping on the job. Thank God for unions. Okay. All right, face down.
Yeah. Lift your feet just a little bit and
yes.
back down. All right.
Yes.
So we're going to approach as if he's a runner and he's about to go to an event. So this is a practice of pre-event massage, and although this is a demonstration, this should only be done by a licensed massage therapist. So we're going to approach the muscles that are going to be mostly used for the activity in question, in this case running, which is the entire legs as well as the whole body. And we're going to start with a technique called tap and mint, which is just to really invigorate the muscles. I'm going to work the calves, hamstrings, and the glutes. Do some compression. It's really just to get the blood flowing and really prep him for this race.
Is the calf muscle the most difficult muscle to loosen and stretch?
I would say it's probably the hamstring, which is one of the largest muscles. So just the whole back of the leg.
All right.
So that's some real basics of what to do before a race. After, it's really just, again, compression towards the heart. Much lighter this time. It's slower. We're not really looking to invigorate the muscle. We're looking to calm the muscle down. This would be a post technique. Now, let's say that he's been training. And this is kind of most of the work that goes into massage is the restorative, helping them condition their body for an event. So, Andy,
one thing.
Absolutely.
You're attempting to help blood flow back to the heart.
Correct.
So that it's reoxygenated?
It's resupplying the body with oxygenated blood. That is correct.
All right.
So a lot of people do come in with something called plantar fasciitis, which a lot of runners see plantar fasciitis. It happens mostly in the heel, but it also relates to the calf. So I'm going to expose your calf for you so everybody can kind of see that. So we're really working on a specific tendon that relates to it, but it's fasciitis is the fascial tissue, so it's more of that myofascial technique. So this is a technique called skin rolling, which helps to loosen that fascial layer. It's typically done without lotion, without any type of lubricant, and that's just to really help break up that adhesion. Also stretching is something that would be important.
Yeah, it feels good.
Yeah. Really open that up.
Boy.
Tell the body to send the blood flow there.
The calf muscles always are so tight.
For you or for?
For me, yes. Yeah. I run and walk and a lot, and they're so hard to stretch.
Yeah. And a lot of times, being a massage therapist, it's about educating the people who walk in your door and what they can do when they're not with you. So sending them home with homework and ways that they can treat their own body. We have tennis balls that are great that I tell clients to use. You can kind of put it on the floor and just roll around it on the larger muscles in the leg and even in the back. So tennis balls are great. Lay on the ground, that's a lot of pressure. You could put it between you and a wall. Just kind of work it around.
Aren't there some products you can buy, like the styrofoam rolling rollers?
Yeah, styrofoam rollers are great in a lot of ways. And I tell a lot of my clients, because we're not allowed to diagnose as massage therapists or treat a condition. We can help. Everything is for relaxation purposes. And that's just basically by law. But there's a lot of things that we can, the foam roller. So I tell a lot of clients to use YouTube, which is a great reference. If it has a lot of views, it's probably pretty good. That goes with stretching of specific muscle groups. That goes with using a foam roller. There's other products out there other than a foam roller. There's it's called a Theracane. It's a wonderful product.
Yes, I have one.
It's a
flexible bar.
Yeah, it's a trigger point tool. It's shaped kind of like a cane, and you can use it to find various trigger points in the body and really hold on to it. The plantar fasciitis is, although, as I mentioned, it relates to the calves, it's really in the bottom of the heel. So it's working this tendon and flexing the tendon, bringing it right to the top of the surface and working it out.
That's a long-lasting injury, isn't it?
Plantar fasciitis? For some people. Some people can get over it right away, so it really, really depends. Another ailment to runners is shin splints.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of people get shin splints. One great way to take care of shin splints that can be done on your own is a technique called pin and stretch. So we shorten the muscle by flexing the toes towards the knee, and we find on the outside of the leg the tibialis anterior muscle, and we can pin it and then stretch the muscle.
Wow.
And shorten, pin, yeah, and lengthen the muscle.
Wow. There's a telltale sign for the client, a sharp pain when you're working the area. Is that a sign of some sort?
That is a good cue. Yeah,
because when you were working the heel there, I felt pain. I don't ordinarily feel when I'm wearing a shoe or walking or running.
Yeah, a lot of times people notice more plantar fasciitis when they are barefoot on a hard surface, and it just, I mean, your body is responding more to a hard surface and to a different stimuli. So something, again, at home treatment, frozen water bottles are great for aiding with plantar fasciitis. Just put it on the floor and roll your foot across it. The water bottles work great when they're frozen. They have these nice ridges that really help break up those adhesions in the foot. And then the ice itself is going to decrease inflammation.
Mm-hmm. Great stuff.
That's about all I got.
That calf muscle is controlling the Achilles.
Correct.
Right? Which is attached to the heel underneath the foot.
And then wraps around.
But the symptom of plantar fasciitis is all in the foot.
Correct.
Right? But the one of the culprits is the tightness of that calf muscle, correct?
Correct.
Yes.
So it's really, you know, it's that old saying that the knee bone's connected to the ankle bone, connected to the foot bone. Yeah, everything is so interconnected and working together that a problem, you know, a lot of people have knee issues that go beyond sports. And a knee problem, you know, a natural reaction might be go for the knee and work in the knee. But a lot of times it's figuring out the things that are wrong in the movement of the ankle. So a lot of times knee can be from the ankle, it can be from the hips. There's a lot of different things. Runners who have knee pain often have it on the interior side, so towards the inside of their knee. A lot of times that's because when they run, it's called pronating. It's actually flexing the foot away from the body. So if we can help get somebody to, I'm gonna use a little bit of lotion on you. If we can help retrain the muscles to have the toes point towards the body, you can help recondition that muscle back, and it can help alleviate a lot of knee pain for some people.
Feels great.
Good.
Yeah.
Good. You know, and loose. A lot of sports is just, it's also like with the stretching, it's increasing the range of motion.
Yes.
So we're going to do something for the hip. So this is great for the IT band.
Right over here, right?
Oh, absolutely.
Oh, mine are horrible.
Okay.
Horrible.
So this really brings the IT band to the surface. This is an issue with a lot of runners. and can palpate the muscle, do some traction. So this is the opposite of a pin and stretch. This is just a stretch. Mm.
That thing is really bothersome for me, both sides.
Is that pressure okay for you?
Oh yeah, that's fine.
Okay, good.
But boy, do I need to be on top of stretching those all the time, or I get symptoms. I would imagine a lot of people interpret IT band tightness as some sort of degenerative hip problem.
In some cases it can be, yeah, but that doesn't necessarily. You know, most people, and I'm one of those people too, I have what's called an anterior pelvic tilt. So it's basically the front of my pelvis is dropped down. So it's retraining different muscles to compensate for that, as well as, you know, and something that I personally do, I see a chiropractor to help with that too. So, you know, there's really no one form of therapy that is the end-all be-all for everything. You know, physical therapy is great, chiropractic care is great. It's just a matter of what's great for each individual person.
Mm-hmm. Which has more control for the runner, the quad or the hamstring?
Well, the hamstring is really generating more of the power.
You're stretching my quad right now,
I am
right?
Stretching your quad right now. That is correct. So, this is just a little bit of a stretching technique.
Am I tight?
You're a little tight.
Yeah.
Yeah. Doing okay?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Feels great, though.
Good. Very good.
I mean, there's that little edge of, what, pain, but it's a good feeling.
Yeah,
because it's releasing itself the more you stretch it.
Yeah, you got it. So then, like with the calves, we can go back to a nice calf stretch for you, get it down. So we're gonna do a technique that's called a PNF stretch. So I'm gonna have you push up against my arm, very good, and relax. So what that does is that really kind of tricks your muscles to really relax and get that stretch in.
Again?
Yep, go ahead. And relax. Very good. That's a great stretch.
Mm-hmm.
That's really opening that up.
Yeah, I can feel it now in the ankle and in the Achilles area.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
So some rocking. I mean, there's hundreds of different massage techniques, and we can incorporate and use all of them to the benefits of an athlete.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not just, and that's where I say that, you know, Swedish is a modality of massage. Deep tissue is a modality, whereas sports massage is more of an approach towards the body. Any other areas of ailments?
Well,
the lower back. Low back.
Yeah, the lower back, and I blame it on the running. Years of pounding on the pavement.
I'm sure.
I'm blaming it on that, but I really don't know. It could be a mechanical problem of mine, the way I run. I don't know. But
yeah.
I think just about every American is going to tell you they have lower back pain.
To some degree, or at some point in their life, everybody's going to deal with some sort of low back.
Talked to the doc about it once, and he said to me, "The problem with your back, Mr. Sullivan, is your front."
That is the truth in some cases.
Yeah.
You know, the body doesn't like extra weight.
Yeah, lose some weight and your back won't hurt you. Now, again, your intuitive hands. Tell me what you think.
Okay, so what I'm feeling is I'm feeling tightness in these QL muscles.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm kind of using layman's terms and abbreviated names of the muscles in the low back. They're tight. A lot of times, you know, you yourself kind of joke about that you have a little bit of a belly, and that's okay.
Yeah.
It will drop that pelvis down, which will shorten these muscles.
It pulls it.
So we can work in opposite directions of the muscle to help stretch the muscle. You're tight down here.
Yeah. I'm going and I'm a wreck. Let's face it. I'm a wreck. We become high maintenance. Aren't the, this is the largest muscle in your body?
The hamstrings.
The hamstrings are the largest muscles in your body. But the glutes are also...
Like the strongest. So this whole section kind of makes up the strongest.
Strongest muscle structure in your body.
Yeah. So, and they're, you know, the glutes are really important to help with low back, low back discomfort, low back pain. There's not as many muscles in the actual low back area as you would think, whereas there's a lot going on in the glutes that help control the hips. You know, another thing is just talking about range of motion. You know, that's another big thing that we do in sports massage, is trying to increase the range of motion of a person. And especially with somebody's hips, it's a ball and socket joint similar to your shoulder. So your shoulder, in any given day, you can have so much movement. You can raise your arm up to hail a cab, or, you know, reach back to grab a paper from somebody in your office.
Right.
But with your hips, you're really just moving them back and forth. But that ability for range of motion is out to the side. It's similar to the arm.
Yes.
So, and it really is one of those things. If you don't use it, you lose it. You know, that's why stretching and yoga and all those things are so important to help maintain a healthy body.
So now, again, I feel sensitivity in that area, and it's like a sore spot, like I felt in my heel.
Yeah.
I haven't felt it anywhere else up and down the leg except in my heel and in the glute area.
Okay.
So is that an indication that things are going wrong in those areas?
Not necessarily that things are going wrong. It just, like I said, it just your interpretation of what's going on in the body.
All right.
So this muscle right here, there's three muscles that really play a big role in this hip that are in this area. One of the most important for, in my own opinion, releasing low back pain is called the piriformis.
You know, difficult to find and stretch.
Yeah.
The piriformis. Oh, what a culprit. I've been told about it by the ortho guys.
Yeah.
Difficult to stretch it.
Well, and that's why I say that YouTube is an incredible resource for things like stretching. So, and then we always leave some level of length and
what is that you're doing right now?
So this is just kind of, it's like a nerve stroke is what it's called.
Yes.
It's just really kind of stimulating the nerves and saying just kind of relax, everything like that.
Okay. All right. Wow. Now the problem is one side of my body is flexible.
Yeah.
And relax the other side. I'm going to walk out of here lopsided. So the most likely... likely trouble spots for a runner are going to be calf, hamstring, glutes,
piriformis, IT band. I mean, IT it's the band. Whole gambit of the leg. It could be one, it could be all, it could be any.
And the person who has lower back pain could be the victim of dysfunction all the way along that system.
Absolutely.
The band, the hamstring, even the quad. And the calf muscle.
Think about it this way. Your feet are the first contact with the ground. So any type of compression coming to the ground is coming up through your feet. So it starts at the lowest point and works its way up.
Yeah.
So the dysfunction could be in the foot. It could be working anywhere up.
Yeah. Andy, it's been great.
Thank you.
I got a free massage tonight. Did you see that? I want to thank, of course, Massage Envy Spa. For, in a sense, lending us Andy Lukasiewicz, and I want to thank Blueberry Hill for, as they always do, so generously hosting us this evening. And on camera, there's Quinn Newman and Alex Wolasiewicz. I've been hit with some heavy Polish names tonight, but I'm struggling. Paul Morehouse, one of my directors, Lucas Clark, one of my directors, and of course David Carafa, my producer. And once again, thank you so much, Massage Envy Spa and Blueberry Hill. My name is Terry Sullivan. This has been the Insight Corner I'll be right home, Dolly, okay? I promise. A little lopsided, but I'll be right home. Thank you.